Nice turnout. Thank you, everyone. My name is Ron Muriera, and I am the national. I wear a lot of hats in the community. A lot of people know me by the different hats I wear. This evening, I represent the Filipino American National Historical Society. We are one of the co-presenters for this evening's community screening of the Delano Manongs. I sit on the National Board of Trustees of the Filipino American National Historical Society, representing Northern California region. I'm also the administrator slash president of the Santa Clara Valley chapter of the Filipino American National Historical Society. Just briefly, FANHS is a national organization. Our mission is to preserve, document, and disseminate information on the historical contributions of Filipinos in the United States. There are 30 chapters nationwide, and Santa Clara Valley is number 8, which means that we're one of the OG chapters, having started. We're in the top 10. So we do have a table outside, as well as we have some informational tables of some of our community partners who I will also point out this evening before we begin the screening of Delano Manongs. So again, thank you so much and welcome. Before we do that, Andres, I wanted to introduce Teresa Castellanos, who's going to provide a welcome from the Santa Clara County Office of Human Relations. Teresa.
Good evening, everybody. We're very happy that you're here. We're very excited. As you all know, and if you're a studier of history, social movements never happen in one ethnic group. They happen multiculturally, they happen building coalitions, and this is the exciting thing about tonight, is that we get to have that conversation, we get to see that history. And so for people who study history, we know that the Filipinos walked out first, and then it was the Mexicanos who walked out in solidarity, and that was the beginning of a social movement that started in terms of farmworkers' rights. And so it's very exciting to be in the same room together to talk about that history, to talk about that legacy, so that in the future we continue building that legacy that is multicultural, multigenerational, and multilingual. So we are very happy that you are here.
I just want to also acknowledge some additional VIPs that we have in the house. We have Miriam Castañeda, who's the chair of the Santa Clara County Human Relations Commission. So are you here, Miriam? Thank you so much for joining us this evening. We also have Clarence Magalejos, who is the chair of the San Jose Human Relations Commission. And Clarence, are you here this evening? Clarence also sits on our FANHS Santa Clara Valley Chapter Advisory Board. So thank you so much, Clarence. Right now I'd like to introduce Andres Quintero from the Office of Assembly Members, Speaker Pro Tem, Mara Campos. Andres.
On behalf of Civil Speaker Pro Tem Mara Campos, I'd like to recognize FANHS for the excellent work you've been doing in showcasing and highlighting the contribution of the Filipino community, and also the excellent work that you've done in bringing Delano Manongs. I know that you were instrumental in making this happen. We're very, very proud that you've done this. I was just talking to one of my buddies out here, my brother Andre McPillack, and let him know that I felt a little felt bad that I didn't know the history. I had heard about it, and I'm out of right here. He said, "You, my folks didn't know what that was." So I said, "All right, I guess I don't feel that bad now." But I'm glad that we're learning more about it tonight. So on behalf of some Speaker Pro Tem Mara Campos, I'd like to present you a certificate of the Filipino American National Historic Society.
Great. Thank you so much, guys. And for your work also, thank Assembly Member Speaker Pro Tem Campos as well. Right now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce a very good friend of mine. She is an amazing woman in terms of getting the story out, but also the work that she's done as a filmmaker. She, if I can just like briefly read a little in terms of her background. She's, of course, filmmaker, director of Delano Manongs, but she's also been involved in other documentary films as well. She received an Emmy Award for the documentary Six in America, which was broadcast on PBS. She produced and directed Little Manila, Filipinos in California's Heartland, which also aired on PBS stations, and she produced Sounds of Hope for Frontline World. Earlier this year, she returned from Tacloban in the Philippines, where she filmed the aftermath of Typhoon Haiyan for the United Nations Children's Fund, UNICEF. In 2009, she, very well recognized, well received, was named one of the most influential Filipino women in the United States by the Filipino Women's Network. She and her filmmaking partner, Niall McKay, they founded Media Factory, a media production company in 2004 who produced this beautiful documentary that you're about to see. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Ms. Marissa Aroy. Marissa.
Thank you, everyone. I know you could be home watching The Voice or something on TV. Oh, it's not on tonight. That's why you're here. Thank you for coming. I made this documentary because I never had anything like this growing up. There was nothing about Filipino history, Filipino-American history. It's as if we didn't exist at all. And so for me, this is done for me as a younger person. This is done for the younger generations of people. And my hope is that they're able to have it in their high school and college classrooms and be able to discuss it. And one of the great things about being able to bring this around to different locations is actually all the stories that all of you have, because I know every single one of you has a story, either about the Manongs or being in the fields or having family who immigrated here and had to really struggle to be the successful people you are today. So I look forward to having that conversation with you after the film. So please turn off your cell phones, and I look forward to our discussion afterward. Thank you so much for being here.
We're affectionately called the Manongs, the Filipino word for elders. Kind-hearted old Filipino men with no families of their own.
So, what did everyone think about the film? A selfie! They did it. I also want to acknowledge, just came in during the film, San Jose Council member Ash Kalra. Thank you so much, Ash, for being here. I know if there's some other folks, dignitaries, VIPs in the room, but thank you so much for joining us. For this community screening. So now what we're going to do is we're going to have a conversation. I know many folks may have some questions or want to share and ask Marissa some things about how this film came about in more detail. So I'm ready to take some questions. Don't be shy. People are processing. Yes, me.
Where they have that big building that is a community house for the Manongs. Where is that located?
Agbayani Village.
Where in Agbayani Village is in Delano, California.
With the help of all the members of the EFW and volunteers and a lot of college students. In fact, I'm sure there must be some people here who had worked on, anybody here worked on Agbayani Village? Yes? Not really. Not in that sense. Full dance halls.
Okay.
wonderful. I'm trying hard not to cry right now. My name is Sarah Gonzalez. I'm executive director of the Filipino Youth Coalition. And earlier, Ron, I had asked you if I could show this film to the Filipino youth because this is something that they need to see. And I have youth from 5 high schools in San Jose, in the Eastside Union High School District. And I wonder if we could talk with the district administrators and ask for a special screening in the assembly, in the gyms, in the assembly halls for our students soon. And if Marissa, if you're still around, maybe you could help us and make it possible.
Sure, Monday afternoon, screening in the evening time in San Francisco State, but Monday afternoon.
How long are you I know you live in the East Coast, right? How long are you staying? How long are you going to be in the area?
I'm on tour with the film until the 30th.
The Marissa Aroy tour, the Delano Manongs tour.
Thank you.
I mean, absolutely, my goal is really to get this to the younger generation of Filipino Americans.
Because you know our youth today, it's hard to get them to come here, but if we go to them, then the value is beyond expression. Thank you, Ryan. We'll do it, okay?
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation.
Fred has a question right there.
I just wanted to mention that Richard Chavez, who was shown in the film, was a carpenter, and he was in charge of the construction of Bayani Village. And I think there's something seriously missing from the film. Philip Vera Cruz, Vice President of UFW, and many other Filipinos who were around the leadership of the UFW were sorely disappointed. Like, I know Philip felt like it was a stab in the back when Cesar went to the Philippines to meet with President Marcos, who was such a brutal dictator in the Philippines. And it caused a cleavage between the Filipinos and Chavez himself.
And can you also introduce yourself so folks know? Can you introduce yourself so folks
know? I'm Fred Hirsch. I'm Vice President of Plumbers and Fitters Local 393 and a delegate to the South Bay Labor Council, and our family spent 1967 and 1968 in Delano working with the Manongs and with Cesar Chavez. One thing that I thought about tonight is the Manongs ran Filipino Hall. Filipino Hall became the center of strike activity. And they were the ones who had to get up earliest of any of the farm workers in the world because they had to make breakfast for everybody.
I just want to comment real very quickly on Fred's comment. Yes, there are actually probably 1,000 stories with every word that is said. There are 1,000 stories behind it, and certainly I grappled with trying to tell that story about Cesar Chavez's trip to the Philippines, because I know there are a lot of Filipino students who at the time, not just the Filipino students, but the Filipino community, who were very upset about that trip. It steers the conversation away from the Union and from the Manongs, and that's the only reason why we didn't tell it. And we wanted to keep this documentary at a length where it could be used in classrooms and have discussions. But it was something I grappled with because there were so many strong feelings about that. And Richard Chavez, who also was on that trip, when you hear the stories that they tell from their side of what they felt going to the Philippines, I really did grapple with, well, whose side do I tell, or do I tell both sides of that story? And it was just a little too long to add in. But as far as Richard was concerned, he was very proud of going to the Philippines. Him and Cesar were very happy to be there, happy to go to the fields, happy to see Filipinos in the Philippines, and didn't realize the ramifications of how big they were here in the U.S. and what that would mean for them when they met with Marcos. All the way in the back there.
Camille's getting exercise.
Hi, good evening. Thanks for putting this together. My question was about Philip Veracruz. He's also a hero. I was curious how you wanted to balance his portrayal, because he is very crucial philosophically and politically in the unionization of Filipinos and Chicano Mexicanos. And I'm just curious what your take was on.
My goal really was to get a lot of Larry Itliong out there, because nobody had really heard about him. If you were a Filipino American student and you had studied Filipino American history, you have a book about Philip Veracruz that you can read and learn a lot about him, and he's become a big hero. And there was nothing really about Larry Itliong and how he began the strike. And he even has, even further than that, when he came in 1929, he was part of the Alaskan Cannery Workers Union. He was part of the Asparagus Workers Union in Stockton, California. So, and probably more than anything, I was just fascinated by Larry Itliong. When you look at him in those photographs, he's a striking man, and he has a sort of bravado, and I wanted to know more and more about him. So Delano Manongs, it has just a touch of everyone in it, any of the leaders, but really I wanted you to get to know Larry Itliong more.
Would you ever consider a movie or something about their relationship, Larry and John?
Oh yeah, they have a really interesting relationship. I don't think they like each other so much. You know? It's true. In Philip Veracruz's book by Lillian Villanueva and Craig Charlin, Philip Veracruz has a line in there saying, "Oh, I think Larry, when he quit, he joined the Teamsters." Now that was not true. First of all, Larry never would have done that to the UFW. But it's been in that book for decades now, and so that's really the impression you have of what happened to Larry Itliong, that he went to the other side and joined the Teamsters Union. And you know, I think there was drama with all the leadership. There's always inner drama there.
Other questions or other comments? Yes, over here. And thank you, Camille, for being the runner.
Thanks, Camille. Hi, my name is Christina. So my great-grandfather was actually a Manong in Stockton, but his immigration story was really different from my own parents. And I actually didn't find out that he was a Manong until I was in college and in an Asian American Studies class and kind of talking to my mom excited about it. And she kind of just mentioned in passing, like, oh, by the way, your grandfather was a Manong, like it was no big deal. But I kind of felt like, you know, I had ownership over this history that I didn't really feel like I had complete ownership. And seeing this, I got really, really, really emotional. Like, I ugly cried near the end. Because I really don't feel like there's anything like this for people like me who kind of just hear things in passing but don't have anything, like, tangible or visible to see to learn. So I had one small comment and then a question. In the beginning, you mentioned that Manong is... it means elder in Filipino. I'm Ilocano, so I actually thought it meant older brother the whole time. So maybe you can make it, I don't know. I always read that it was older brother and not an elder.
It is more older brother, but the way we look at them now, the context of this film, it's more elder.
Mm-hmm. Technically, you're correct. And I guess my question is, what did your research behind the film look like? Because, you know, I guess I'm pretty interested in looking at like archives of that time and seeing if there's anything that maybe, you know, youth that are my generation that are interested in kind of learning about, you know, their ancestors. What did that kind of look like for you?
It really took a village to make this documentary, and that was a lot of the Filipino American National Historical Society and all the archives they have, which they hold in Seattle, but also the Stockton chapter, and also various people in the Filipino community gave things for the documentary. So two of the archived interviews with Larry Itliong were actually taped by people in the community. Mignon Gelly was a 16-year-old who went to Delano to interview Larry. She knew nothing about the UFW or the Farmworkers or anything. And so her questions are very simple and basic, and it really helped to explain who he was and what he was doing at the time. That was one. The second one was from Deborah Louie, who was a student at UCSC at the time. And Larry Itliong had come into their classroom and talked about his experiences being here in the U.S. and being with the union and beforehand. And those were really love. That's where you get that I've got the ability to make you think I'm pretty. He's talking to that. You see a Santa Cruz class and flirting with the women. and then there was a lot of research done at different universities at their archival libraries at Wayne State University, which holds the UFW archives, UCLA, UC Berkeley, a lot from Stockton, Yale University, did I say Berkeley? San Francisco State, several of the, and there were filmmakers who helped out, and it was really just like, it's taken me 5 years to put 30 minutes together. So it's been a long process of going through. I shouldn't
have my PhD now.
Yeah.
Can you give me a PhD?
Yeah, I will.
Okay.
I got a question.
Towards the end, when there's like a group of people, there's a woman with sunglasses. I believe that's my cousin. Because they live with us now. And I have lived with them back in the late 70s, and I even went to big rates, and I was earning $1 a box.
What year is this?
1979,
1980. Wow.
$1 a box. And it's 30 pounds. And you have to clean the grate and pack it, and it has to be 30 pounds or more, otherwise you have to redo it.
Wow.
And I had to live with them for a summer, and that was my earning.
And were you part of the union?
No.
were they trying to make sure you wouldn't?
My cousins in, they live in Fresno, so I just lived with them for the summer. And
yeah.
That photo, she looks familiar, so I don't know if that's her or not, but I swear to God it is.
just own it.
It is your cousin. That's my aunt.
What's that?
That's my aunt. And you're saying that your cousin's from Fresno?
Yeah.
I'm like, that's my aunt that was in the.
That was fine. Okay, my cousin is Muriera.
That's a family you have on right here.
Multi-ethnic community. All the whites went to school on one side, but all the people of color and the poor whites went to school at the side that I went to. But my grandfather and my uncles were compadres to the Chavezes and very involved in the Filipino community, and we ate in that Chinatown all the time, all Filipinos. So it really brings back a lot of memories for me, and the struggle of that whole community and all of that upheaval with the background of the civil rights movement. So it's a very important era. Yeah.
Thank you for sharing that, Mary Jane. We have a question back there.
Yes. So will the film be screened on PBS, and can we purchase it to share with our families and communities?
Yes, it will be shown in PBS in May of next year as part of the Asia Pacific Islander Heritage Month on PBS. And it's going to be packaged with, I think, with two other Filipino programs, one called Jimmy and one called Harana. And I'm not sure, I think there's a fourth one, but I'm not sure. But yeah, so look for it in May.
Yeah.
And, yes.
What about?
Wait, we have a question.
Wait, she was sorry.
She had another question.
I just wanted to say that a very dear friend of ours, Jay Tamsey,
and Jimmy Tamsey, his dad ended up marrying a Latina, a Mexican woman. And so I'll be at the Filipino Center on the October 26th where they're going to honor Jay, which is, he calls his aunt and uncle, for a young Filipino who is doing dynamic work in Kern County. He's the president of the Chamber of Commerce there. And so eventually there was this intermingling, and Latinos married the Filipinos, and so that's a great story that need to be told too, that eventually there was that great union between us. And thank you so much for bringing that story to us. I happened to work with ARB in the 70s and worked at the Abiyami village. I did a lot of the investigations against Jamar Farms and the Gallo wineries, and it was just amazing that when visiting the Abiyami village and looking at the elders and spending time with them, even though a lot of them had already retired, was amazing. And if you don't know this, Obama declared 40 acres, which Abiyami village sits on, as a historical monument. And we were able to go to see that special presentation by Salazar, who is the Secretary of Interior, but that's also part of the history that it was named a historical monument by Obama several years ago.
I believe they're also trying to get Filipino Hall, also in Delano, as a landmark, a historical landmark site as well.
Hi, my name is Angelica Cortez, and my question is sort of how it's depicted in your film of all the moments leading up to 1965, Larry Itliong, and all the mobilizing that was going on between the two communities, and the soundbite that you put in there of Larry Itliong saying, you know, all of this, and we fought so hard, and we're fading to the background. So my question is, what factors do you think contributed sort of to that reality that they fought so hard for it and had such strong conviction, and then they faded away?
Well, there were a number of factors, but one of them would be that they were aging, and they were at the retirement age. And so being on picket lines for 5 years is going to greatly affect them. And you're talking about a dwindling population of Filipino farm workers at the time. So that would be one huge, huge reason. And the second would be that the Filipinos come from AWOC, Agricultural Workers Organizing Committee. It was affiliated with the AFL-CIO before they went together with the NFWA. So all of those Filipino farm workers were hardcore labor people. They knew how to picket old style, where there was a lot of violence in the fields, and so they sort of had to learn about this non-violent approach, this community approach that Cesar and Dolores Huerta were bringing to this new organization. So there was a bit of a learning curve for them in terms of organizing, not just for the workers, but the whole population of people in Delano and then outside of it. So it was really about publicizing, marketing the movement to outside of the workers. So there's that. And the other is that Larry was one of those kind of hardcore union guys.
and he didn't really know where his place was in this new union. And he quit several times. Actually, there are a number of letters that he had left where he was quitting, and then they were asking him to come back. And I think it was because he also saw this dwindling population of Filipino members as kind of a dwindling of his power in the union. So what he wanted to do when he left the union was he started a Filipino-American political association, FAPA, and he was trying to take his energies into getting Filipinos involved in politics. And so he might have quit the union and his power was dwindling there, but he was still organizing up until his death in 1877. That answers it. It's very long, and I mean, there's much more to it, I think, than that, but I hope that answered it.
Hi, I'm Mark Lobbies, and I just want to thank you for introducing this to the general public. I am a product of a model. So that lost generation they talk about is very interesting to me because many of my sister, I have two sisters. My father was 58 when he had me. There's a 25-year age difference between him and my mother. So this story, they were a very loving group of men that I was blessed to be raised around. But they are very mysterious. So when I entered college, it wasn't until I stepped into my first Asian American Studies class that all the answers came of why I was here. And it gave me a rich history to be proud of because we had a disconnect from being Filipino American and home country because of our fathers. So in my search to figure out who my identity is, I think your film also provides, not only validates that, but also brings another piece to it as far as this strife. So thank you very much.
There is also this disconnect as well between my parents who came in post-1965 and their connection with this story, right? Their connection with Filipino-American history. And what a lot of that wave of Filipinos don't realize is that these Manongs took their money and they sent it back to the Philippines. And that educated their nieces and nephews and their family back there to the point that post-65 generation of Filipinos that came in were educated, were professionals, working professionals. They didn't have to come in here necessarily and work the fields, the whole time. So I also want to get this story to that generation. The only way to do that would probably be to get it on TFC, the Filipino channel. Because I don't think they're watching PBS, but that's another story.
We have time for a couple more questions. The gentleman right here in front, then the gentleman here.
It's a great movie. I had heard about a lot of this stuff, generally speaking, but I had never actually heard about the whole contract. I had heard about Filipinos being excluded from the farm worker movement and that kind of thing, or feeling excluded. I had never heard about the impacts of the contract and how that ended up actually creating unemployment within the Filipino community. So that was shocking. To what extent, like, what was the magnitude of that as far? I mean, are we talking about just like a few individuals? Are we talking about like hundreds? It was like 50%. Do you have any sense of how many people?
I don't have numbers. I don't have numbers, but this really was the most complicated part of the documentary to tell because it greatly affected the Filipinos. But telling all that are trying to explain what the hiring halls did, what the contract did, what the hiring halls did, being a member, being like a migrant member, it's all sort of inside baseball. And you're going to lose a general audience, and you're going to lose a lot of students if you go into it too much. So that's where really the books that are about this, Matt Garcia has a great new book out, Mary Powell has a great new book out about Cesar Chavez. They go into it a little more than this film does. But the Filipinos had these great work crews that they had for years, where they were with each other, and
you know, for good reasons, the UFW wanted to change that and have a diverse work group. But what it meant was the Filipinos were used to that work crew of the same Filipino group going in and having one contract dissipate, right? So, you know, in some aspects it was good. It meant that there was this intermingling. It meant that there was this marrying between the Latinos and the Filipinos. But it also meant that they lost that consistency of work. But no, I don't have any numbers on it.
This gentleman right here, then we'll take one more question over in the middle. But, okay.
Good evening. I was very lucky that I was raised with a father who was best friends with Cesar Chavez. My father was Ernie Avecchia. My name is Jacob Avecchia. And they went back in the days of in the late 50s in the CSO here in San Jose. And I can tell you, one of the very first times I went to Delano, I noticed that there was all these people that finally looked like Cesar, because Cesar didn't look very Mexican. He looked very Filipino to me. And so it was very interesting. But I want to get away from the breaking up part of the separation of Filipinos from the United Farmworkers for minutes, just to make people realize that, you know, if we have to wonder, in 1965, if the Filipinos hadn't pushed Cesar into getting into the strike, where the United Farmworkers and where the Cesar Chavez movement, all that would have been without that pressure from the Filipino community.
Thank you. This will be the last question, and then yeah, you get to have the last question.
She's already over. Okay. So I want to thank you for putting in all the time and effort and research to put this together. It makes me proud of my heritage, and I have my daughter here and her friend who's also Filipino American, that we can, you know, pass the information on to the next generation, because my daughter is a granddaughter of a Manong. My father was a Manong. He came in the 20s from Luna La Union, Ilocano. We never found out exactly how old he was because he changed his birth date so he can come at a younger age to America. But he joined the army when World War II broke out. So he had been working in the agriculture all that time until World War II. He was in the army, got educated to eighth grade, was in Korean War, and even then, after being in the army, he still was not able to marry because there were anti-miscegenation laws, as the film had shared. So he went to Mexico to marry my mother. And after they had us, I remember them taking us to marches with Cesar Chavez in the Salinas Valley. And so after he retired from the army because they wanted to send him to Iceland, after 22 years in the US Army and two wars, he worked side by side picking strawberries with my mother because that's what he could find after being in the US Army. That's the kind of work he could find at that time. So I just wanted to share that as part of this history, as part of the connection that I feel to some of you who have shared your, you know, close connection to the Manong community, and also to pay tribute to my father, who kept all this a secret. I didn't find this out until I was 19 and started in college and investigating. And so it's something that I'm sharing on his behalf, because one of the things he did share with us when he decided to settle in the Salinas Valley to have our family, like somebody said, 25 years older than my mother, to have us kids, is he said that they would never let him go to restaurants in the 50s in the Salinas Valley because they would say monkeys are not allowed. And that's the only thing he shared about his history and his experience with all the racism at the time. Thank you. Oh my gosh.
for our family, we've just lost the last person of that generation, and I think a lot of this just struck, because this is the only way that my two-year-old is going to know about these things if the stories are preserved. So on a personal note, I thank you for that. And I think the other thing, like the reason why I was on the planning committee to make this a reality is I had shared with Ron and Teresa Castellanos that what I think was really, that stuck out to me in the video was when you showed the unity, and I know there's a lot of division, and I know that there's been strife after that, but I strongly believe as a Filipina who leads a Latino organization, the only way that social justice is going to happen is if we bind together, and that's the message that I want our communities of color to start hearing and to believe it, because like you said, we're just going to keep pitting each other against each other. Nothing is going to, you know, move forward. And now there's issues of immigration and fair wage and living wage. All of these things affect all communities of color, and it's not going to be until we see the unity that you put in this bill that we're going to be able to advance those things forward. So I wanted to thank you for that, and I wanted to make sure that that piece of unity is something that we all walk away with.
Well, first off, I want to thank Marissa for being here this evening. That conversation with all of you. And I also want to thank all of you for sharing your stories and your experiences with all of us. You know, I think part of the reception is for not only the opportunity to talk with Marissa, but to talk with each other. This is just one story. There are so many stories that are out there. And having been involved in social justice movements and being an educator and performing artist, a lot of the students that are now grown, that have been my students, are turning to the medium of film. And they all ask me, Kuyuran, what can we focus film on? These are Filipinos and Filipinas. And I'm going to steer a couple of them your way to say, if you want to find out, you know, what some things that you should work on in terms of projects, look at your history, look at your family, but I think I have someone that you can speak with that may provide you with some light. But thank you once again, everyone. And before we go, know that there are information tables out there. Thank you so much to Andres Quintero, Assembly Member Speaker Pro Tem Rocampos. We have a table out there. FANHS, we have a table out there. I want to also thank the Registrar of Voters who have a table, Santa Clara County. Matter of fact, they're looking for election officers. So if you're interested, they will be happy to take your name. There's $125 stipend. So to be an election officer, so that's pretty good. Not just, you get a little compensation, pay for gas, maybe a meal. Okay, so, and then they also, and also if you haven't registered to vote, they also have forms out there. So once again, thank you so much to everyone for making this community screening such a success. Thank you, Marissa. And just to let everyone know, you're supposed to sit in the movie outside. And Marissa, do you? Yeah, nobody touch Marissa's lumpia, okay? Special order. So thank you, everyone. And thank you to the Santa Clara County Office of Human Relations for being our host.
Asian Americans, just opening the conversation around Asian Americans and all the topics that are never expressed due to
from the district office. He's a member, he's a specialist.
Cerna Grant is a foundation that they offer grants to artists and organizations. Right now, it's a grant for individual artists
for social change.
So, I definitely want to
plan on that. Hello!
Hi!
Nice meeting you. Congratulations on the great film. I look forward to sharing it with my students.
Yeah.
What are they?
I know, but what are they filled with?
since I missed her, I went to work in 2006, so 2007.
History about the Manongs and how important they were and their contribution to a major labor union, historical labor union. And so I'm so happy that you're able to watch it. I hope you get something out of it and it makes you hungry to learn more.
It's like UCLA and all that, and then plus you got all those Filipinos and records that don't talk to anybody anyway. They're too ugly. Making the big duck, big bucks.
Yeah, good. I hope you make well. You do well. More and more and more stuff. But I'm trying to put a shadow board thingy. I don't know. But I'm trying to think about how I can put this area together. Because I know a lot of you are just here. So but there's only three or four people still alive from the 40s that have the history. So I'm trying to find out where they're at now.
Yeah.
All the 50s. All the other ones that passed away. There's a few left.
Do you have any contact information we can talk about the screening?
Marissa, they want to take a picture of you. Thank you. I was so moved. There's a sign over there that says restrooms. I don't want it.
Not a problem.
Perfect.
Is that the six? Yeah, it's huge. It's huge. It doesn't fit in any pocket.
Oh, yeah.